today, taking a break from the convention, still have my badge on. I'm going across the street to Jade Apartment Complex. Pretty new apartment complex. Saw it on a Pomsey video, which is why I reached out to them. They're the first ones to get back to me. First ones I'm going to see. And let's see if it's the right place for me. I can't believe that was almost 15 months ago. Wow. Welcome back to the channel, everyone. For those of you who are new, I'm Shane, the New Yorker in Vegas. And first, I want to give a very heartfelt thank you to everyone, friends and strangers alike, who sent me a lot of amazing words of encouragement after my video last week where I contemplated ending the channel. I was in a rut and y'all have really kind of helped me get out of that. Still a work in progress here and here, but you really, just thank you. It means a lot to me. Today's vlog will chronicle my move, which I can't believe has been over a year now, to Las Vegas. Not Vegas, now not my apartment. So, but you know, that's neither here nor there. And it'll also serve as your how-to guide, step-by-step, if you are thinking about moving to Las Vegas. But first, I want to dispel certain myths and just voice some concerns with reasons that some people have for moving to Las Vegas. The first is if you're moving for the gaming. I myself am not a gambler. I will put down the occasional $20 on a roulette machine once or twice a year when a friend visits, but I can't really speak to it in the authority, but you don't have to look far to see the negative impacts that some individuals who moved to Vegas for the gambling and thought they had it under control have felt. It's a very slippery slope. So just please be very diligent and cautious if one of the reasons or the reason you're considering moving to Vegas is for the gaming. And if you or someone you know does have a gambling illness slash addiction, here are some resources that you could look into, and just, you're not alone. Another terrible reason for moving to Las Vegas that you shouldn't do, but your boy here did, and it wasn't the only reason why I moved, there are many, but was looking for love. That idea that maybe Vegas is a good place. It's got so many people from so many different places and you could find your person. And that's not a thing in Vegas. That's not to say you can't meet the occasional great person. I've met some great women that we didn't click in a romantic way, but we became friends afterwards. I'm very thankful for them. But they and I are drops in the bucket to the overwhelming majority of just flaky, ghosty, indecisive, mean, all over the place, heart and head, not really in it kind of people. And I'm not just talking about just the women that I've met. I'm talking about the experiences I've heard from my friends and men, women in the LGBTQIA plus community. It runs the gamut. The majority of people who are single in Vegas are just, I thought New York City was a bad dating scene. Was I wrong? You gotta think about it this way also. There's not a lot of people to choose from. There's what, 2.5, 2.8 million people, and that's including Vegas, Henderson, and the surrounding areas. Half of them are already be in committed relationships. Then half of them, maybe if you're lucky, are what your orientation is. You know, like, you know what I mean, the pool for you. Of half of them maybe are gonna be age appropriate for you. Then who are you really gonna connect with after that? I mean, it's rough. And like, if you're swiping on the apps, you will go through the entire city multiple times very, very quickly. It's a big city, but
small town.
And so it makes it just extraordinarily difficult to meet someone, and it is not a great dating scene. If love is the primary or one of the primary reasons, it's not to say it can't happen, but I mean, I'm gonna be alone for the rest of my life anyway. I've already resigned to that. Just Vegas might not do you any favors though. Just saying. Okay, so all that aside, you have your reasons, the right reasons for you, and you still want to make this move to Las Vegas. So what do you need to know? Let's get into that. So then I went to Jade. It was under a different management company than it is now. The building representative, she took us around and showed us the entire building, from the gym to the pool to Sky Lounge, the common areas, the clubhouse, and so forth. And it was, I mean, like no other building I had ever even had the possibility of living in. In New York City, it would cost four times as much. Not an exaggeration. The craziest part was that we sat by the pool and I was asking these questions to like what the deposit would be, and I was quoted at $200. Now it's probably not that now, but I just went like, and I just paused, I was silent, and the poor woman was like, Did I say something wrong? Oh, what? In New York, a deposit is usually first month's, last month's broker's fee. I mean, you had to put down so much money for it to be such a small amount of money. I was like flabbergasted. And I looked at my friend who was with me, and she was just like, I don't really see a reason why you shouldn't move here. And I was like, well, do you have a mountain view? And because I didn't want to have a strip view, I want to have a mountain view. And she took us to what is now my apartment, and I was blown away. It was just like, wow.
Day two.
Okay. And when you're looking at any apartment anywhere, there's some questions you have to ask. I mean, even before you go into it, know your credit score. That's gonna matter, because you should ask them, what's the credit range you're looking at? Unless you have like superb credit and you don't have any headaches to worry about with that, any fears, because that can sometimes right there exclude an apartment for you, and you don't wanna get your hopes up. So know before you go. If you think your credit might not be up to par, and or your finances may not appear as if you can afford the apartment, find out what the apartment's allowance or lack thereof for a guarantor. And you have to have documentation ready to go, scanned, or bring it in for a copy, you know, driver's license or passport, social security card, or any number of those things. It all depends on the management. They will tell you what you need, but have those ready to go. If you have any pets, ask if they are a pet-friendly building. If so, what pets and what the fees are, as well as what documents you're gonna need to provide. I had to provide a medical history for Hannah. It was $35 a month. There was a pet deposit. What are the application fees? How much are they? Are they refundable? Not just for the application, but for the background check. Sometimes there's two background checks you need to have, both financial and criminal. So just find out what those fees are, and if you get rejected, if they are refundable. Application fees can mount up. Also find out, say you're submitting multiple applications to different places, if from the you can get a copy of your financial and criminal background checks from that first place. Because say they reject you, or you just decide you don't want that. If you can get that, then you can say to the next place and the next place, hey, I just had this done. Will you accept this? And some places will, some people just want the money. But oftentimes they'll be nice and they'll let you use a very recent, like a few days, a few weeks old financial and background check. And you can skirt extra fees for each place you're applying to. So just keep that in mind. The deposit, find out how much it is. Some places it's a full month's rent, sometimes it's a month and a half, sometimes it's as low as mine was, and find out what their policy is for when you move out, as far as retaining it to make sure there's no damage to the apartment and or giving it back what that time frame is, because sometimes you need to bank on that for the next place you're moving to. Just find out. Holding fee. I found out, and this is the first time I ever heard this, Jade, at least at the time, they had a holding fee, and that meant they could hold the apartment for as long as I needed them to. I looked at it in August and was looking at an early October move-in. They're like, well, there's a holding fee for holding the apartment. I was like, how much? And they said, it's about $300, I think. I was like, per month? They're like, no, flat. Again, I was flabbergasted. Like, you could hold it for that long for just that amount of money? Aren't you guys losing money? They're like, I got someone moving in by the holidays who got the apartment in June. Like, $300, flat. Wow. If it's not a very soon move-in, especially if you're moving cross-country, that is, or an out-of-state move, that takes time, ask about a holding fee. And depending on the type of building you're moving to, most apartment complexes in Vegas have some sort of amenities, like a pool or a gym or a business center or whatever it might be. Find out what they are and what those fees are, because those fees are usually not included in the actual base rent. Of course, you're gonna ask about the base rent. I don't need to tell you that, but those are usually added on. And so find out what that is per month on average. And if it's basically, you're gonna be charged that along with your rent, because say your base rent is $1,565, and the amenities are say around another $100, $125 more. In reality, then your rent is $1,700. So it's not a trick, but it is something to keep in mind, because those amenity fees are not optional. You know, it's common space electric, pool maintenance, gym maintenance, cleaning, but that's not an opt-in or an opt-out. They're automatically going to add to your base rent. Ask about that. Having renter's insurance for an apartment in Nevada is not the law. You don't have to have it, but a lot of complexes do require it. I went with Lemonade. I believe Jade recommended them. There are a few different companies that offer renter's insurance. I did the most, pretty much the most base plan, and that runs you about $8 a month, $8 to $12 a month. What the building will do, if they do require, will tell you what to enter in to your account so that they get a notification that you have purchased the insurance. But find out about that, because after you get approved for your apartment, you're going to have to provide that before you can actually move in. You can sign the lease without that, but before you can actually get the keys, quote unquote, you have to have the renter's insurance. Utilities. Now, where I live, stuff like internet, if I were to have cable, electricity, they're separate. I handle that on my own. But stuff like sewage, water, which I'd never been charged for water in my life. It's, that's a New York, that's a New Yorker in me. Those are lumped into those amenity utility fees tacked onto your rent every month. So it's done through the building. However, that being said, it's not always going to be that way. So ask them what utilities are going to be paid for by your complex, by your building, what ones you're responsible for, which ones you're responsible for setting up the accounts for, which I'll get more into that later, and which ones they have the accounts for, but are going to then charge you on the back end for it. Finally, ask how you're going to pay your rent the first month. Usually it's due at the date of move-in or a little bit before. I need to buy a money order, because while my building has an online portal to pay your rent, and I hook up my bank account to it, you know, that's another question to ask. How am I paying my first month, and how am I paying every month after that? They'll tell you when they approve you how they need the deposit and so on and so forth. And then after that, you know, some places it'll be an online portal. I think most places have that now, but some places are still accepting checks. So just know this way you can plan ahead appropriately as to the method with which you're going to be paying that all important rent bill on the first of every month. Also ask when rent is due on the first, but most places, my place included, will give you a grace period of a few days. So just find out what like the date is, just in case, you know, there's a little wiggle room with your pay schedule. Something you should know before you do consider moving is that when your lease is up, in some cities like New York, the landlord kind of just will give you a percentage of what they're going to raise it. And it's been kind of all wackadoo since the pandemic ended. Usually you'll be told the percentage is going to go up every year, and you can kind of anticipate it. And if you're lucky enough to have rent control in New York City, then you know exactly what you're going to raise every year. Nevada didn't have that. No rent control in Las Vegas. And your landlord will raise your rent based on a third-party market evaluation of what the property is worth at that point in time. So it can be a small amount, or it can be an astronomical amount. I can't wait to see what my apartment is going to be marked up to and rent raised when my lease is up. But I kind of cringe to see it, because Vegas has shot up in the market since I moved there, and my building is in high demand, and I can only imagine what they're going to be charging for my apartment. Still not going to be on New York levels, but it's going to be high. So just know that, have that in the back of your head, and that might play into whether or not you're signing a 1 year or longer lease. I signed a year and a half, but yeah, that's another thing to ask. What are your options as far as the length of lease? You know, I want to do the year and a half, because like that's not too short but not too long. I can really kind of figure out what this is for me, and so I'm glad that's what I did. But ask that question as well, and just have in the back of your head that your rent isn't guaranteed to stay within a reasonable margin of percentage when being raised at the end of your lease, when you're renewing it. So just keep that in mind. There's a lot of information. I'm kind of breezing through it with my monotone, convoluted voice and style speaking. So if you would like a physical, or should I say PDF cheat sheet for all these bullet points, just give me a like, give me a comment down below, maybe subscribe, and then direct message me on the email appearing and I will send you a full rundown cheat sheet, New Yorker in Vegas life tip copy. The transactionalness of YouTube makes me feel dirty, but I guess that's the name of the game. All right, so now it's day three. By the time we left yesterday, there really wasn't much to see on the road because it was pretty much dark. We drove at night, drove straight through to about 3-4 o'clock in the morning. Didn't get anywhere near as far as we'd hoped. Well, close enough. We didn't get to St. Louis. Got to about 2 hours before that, a rest stop, a Love's rest stop somewhere in Indiana. So now it's a long 15-hour drive for day three. Beautiful sunrise. Tired.
Slept for about 4 hours. If I didn't, maybe three. I don't know. Long day. But hopefully a good one. Right, Hannah?
Oh, the baby girl.
What? Oh. How was the drive so far? Nah.
And I'll tell you, it wasn't, just personally, it wasn't like an immediate thing. It was like, I guess my soul, my heart knew that this is where I wanted to be. Like, everything had aligned for the first time in my life perfectly to get this apartment. But my head and my worries and my life being trained that things just don't work out was hesitant. I was staying at the Aria. I got like a half mountain view, but what I could see directly from my room was Jade Apartments. It was just like, what is holding me back? So it took me like a day and a half, and I kept going through the numbers and going through the finances, and I was like, can I do this? Can I do all this? Can I do this move? Oh, can I do this? And I did, and I applied. Now in New York, it can take, I mean, I've waited 3 weeks, a month, just to hear a no or just to hear a yes. I saw the apartment on a Friday. I applied late Saturday or early Sunday, and I was leaving the next Friday. And as we're driving out of Vegas, I get the email, congratulations. Welcome to Jade.
What?
Kill for your angel dust.
What? You don't want to be in Kansas City either? I thought so.
I mean, constant in this universe, it's death, taxes, and the Mets lifting you up just to beat you down year after bloody year. Am I the only one who hears those factory bells, alarm thing go off in the suburbs and think, it's the apocalypse? Am I the only one? Ooh, my mouth's getting dry. Time for some wine. Gluck, 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 gluck. Aww. Bottoms up, bitches. And as always, pinkies up. Where was I? So, I had my stuff in storage. This is my life. My whole apartment, everything. Everything I own pretty much is in this storage unit right now, and this camera is not high enough. Once I was approved for the apartment and I had a time frame, it was time to figure out how I was getting all my junk over to Viva Las Vegas. So I had to hire movers. By far the worst part, aside from seeing your bank account dwindle, the worst part of this entire journey for you is going to be dealing with movers. Hands down, bar none, it's atrocious. And I do recommend doing it yourself if you can, sometimes you can't. So you gotta hire movers. I will advise that if you are moving all your stuff, if you're like renting a U-Haul or something like that, if you're driving from the east or middle of the country to Vegas, avoid I-70 in Colorado, because you're not gonna wanna take a truck through the Rockies. You know, you're going up to 11,500 feet, and you can see the video that I have linked below for that drive. It's the most beautiful drive in the country, in my opinion. Avoid that if you have a moving truck. Take 40, go underneath it. You can go I-70 through, you know, Nebraska, Iowa, Illinois, and so forth, if you're coming from, say, the Northeast, but then dip down to 40 because it's a lot flatter of a route for a moving truck. So I eventually got a quote from a place called Beacon Moving. Today's pick up the stuff from storage day. Not all of it, some of it's being sold in theory. And it's raining. Of course, the driver can't find it. So he's like, send me the address. I keep sending him the address and he can't find it. So it was not a beacon for hope, it was a beacon for broke. Cool. Came up with that. Oh, I'm so good at this. Getting them a precise, everything. The inventory was on point. Quoted me at $2,500. I was like, oh, wow, that was by far the best quote I ever got. And why was I so damn naive to believe that was actually going to be what the price was?
Apparently, whoever did the estimated the square, the cubic feet wrong, even though I gave them complete measurements. I ended up taking up 800 cubic feet of stuff.
As they're packing up my stuff, like, I mean, he's Speed Racer. There he goes, there goes Speed Mover. He's a demon on wheels. He's a demon and he's gonna be ripping off someone, and it was me. And then they start saying shit like, oh my god, there's so much stuff. Oh my god, there's so much more. There's so much more. Look, see how it's different from the itinerary? It's,
oh. So the estimate that was 2,500 went up to 42. So it's $4,200 for the move of my stuff cross country. That's just my stuff.
He already packed everything up, so they would have been like another $1,000 just to put it back into storage unit. And I would have go through this whole thing and wouldn't have been on time. So it's like, they got you by the balls. They got you between a rock and a hard place. And what are you gonna do at that point? Swindled, bamboozled, tricked. All those other terms that I can't think of right now that would make this video funnier if I could. Now that's most movers. My friend who lives in Colorado, who I've mentioned before, when she moved, she used Flat Rate, and they're a more well-known company, and I really should have went with them. Their quote was higher, but she didn't encounter any swindling and BS that I did, so I would recommend going with them based on her recommendation. She's a lot more business savvy and well-versed and takes a lot less BS than I do. Go with Flat Rate Movers. Whatever movies you decide, get the time frame. They'll usually give you a couple of options for what dates you would ideally get your stuff by. What happened with me was I moved in on a Monday and they arrived on a Sunday, the following Sunday. And they were supposed to give me a 24-hour heads up so I could be there, so I could be ready. Nope. They outsourced the moving. The moving guy, he had been sitting outside trying to get a hold of me for 3 hours because they gave him the wrong phone number. And I'm cooking breakfast and all of a sudden I get a and a dude looking real angry. And I was like, yes? And he's like, you chained my, and I'm like, yeah. And he's like, is this your number? And I was like, no. He's like, and so he had guys, day workers who were gonna help move the stuff in, and they all left. So it was him and his girlfriend and me. So not only did they upcharge me, the moving company, but because they outsourced and didn't give him the correct information and did not give me a heads up for when he was going to arrive, I had to move my own stuff in, which, yeah, okay, fine. I have no problem doing that if that's what I'm prepared for, but if I'm paying for a service, just be caught. I mean, there's really nothing you can do. It happened, this stuff happens when it happens. There's really not, you can look at Google reviews or Yelp reviews, they're not always gonna be accurate, but ask around, ask your friends, trust your friends who've been through this. I didn't, and that's on me. So I'm gonna find out why you're getting a movement quote. Find out from the building you're moving into, if your building is a true high ceiling freight elevator, and the distance from both the loading dock or entry point to the freight elevator, and then from the elevator to your apartment, because that will factor into the quote for the mover. And finally, really know the claims clause for any damaged stuff. I had so much stuff, family heirlooms, whole furniture, squished, broken, chipped. I filed claims, they never get back to me because they sucked. That's not gonna be everyone's experience, but don't use Beacon Movers. I don't wanna promote them, but this is what their website looks like, so if you see it, run, don't walk. It's a Punch Beetle right there. So here we are in Kansas. We are super duper behind schedule. The rent-a-car is starting to look like a men's dorm, and I would just going to be super excited to sleep in an actual comfy ass bed tonight and just stretch out and not have to get up at the ass crack of dawn. So because last night sleeping in the car, it was just not fun. After you've been approved for the apartment and you've got the mover set up, you gotta set up the utilities that the building itself is not covering. In my case, it was Wi-Fi, and in Vegas, you use Cox. No giggity, no joke. Cox. Cox. And for electric, it's Nevada Energy. If you're coming from an expensive city like New York or LA or San Francisco or so forth, you're gonna be like, oh my God, this is so cheap. It is so cheap. It is so cheap. And it's so cheap compared to that. If you're coming from like middle America where like things are a lot cheaper, you're gonna go there and be like, I remember everyone telling me like, oh my God, you're gonna pay so much electricity during the summertime with the AC. I've never broken $100 in my electrical bill. And that's with AC on most of the day, at times sometimes all day. In New York City, in the winter, I was paying $85 a month. In the summer, with air conditioning units, I was paying sometimes $325 a month. Now, people with houses in Vegas will pay that or more sometimes, but an apartment, a one bedroom like mine, I'm not even paying $100 a month in the summer. In the winter, sometimes my bill is down to $40. Amazing, I'll drink to that. Mm. And I'll drink to the cocks. Cocks! Day five, move-in day. Leaving to La Quinta and see the city. Heading to Las Vegas, move-in day. T minus true zero, surreal. All right, let's go.
We're almost there, baby girl.
Now, all of this was done, checked off every box. I had arrived at my new home, and it was like the starting of a new age for me. Sit home.
Welcome home, baby girl.
It was scary and it was exciting and it was very lonely.
If I'm being completely honest with myself, I don't do alone good. Spent the majority of my life alone. But it's okay, because it could be a lot worse, and depression is manageable and okay. And you have to, I have to take steps to get myself out of that. I'm not gonna not be alone unless I do. So I have to do that. It's gonna be rough the first few weeks. So I'm gonna be crying every night probably. That's okay. I'll have Hannah, thankfully. Wait, there you are. She's right there. That dark blob.
And now it's just me. The reasons I moved to Vegas were plentiful. And a lot of it I covered in the Welcome to New York or Vegas channel, the very first video on this channel. Go check it out if you didn't already. Maybe I'll link that below as well. I needed change, and I need some personal growth. I needed to get in better shape. I wanted to be closer to nature. And I know some people are like, Vegas is nature? I guess the desert is nature. Yes, the desert's nature. And as they say in my favorite movie, 25th Hour, every man, woman, and child should see the desert at least once in their lives. It's not the exact quote, but get the gist.
I lay here now a few days before I'm moving, and it's just, I feel terrified, and I feel like, what the fuck am I doing? I'm doing what everyone else has done. Not everyone, but a lot of people.
But one of the biggest reasons was I felt like life was completely standing still in New York. And it's not to say I don't feel that way in Vegas as well now, a year plus later, but
nothing worthwhile in this world happens without some trepidation, some fear, some pain, some tears.
Felt like maybe my best days were the days I left behind. And that sounds even remotely familiar to you. It's because it's, in my opinion, the best song that Alessia Cara, my favorite music artist, has ever written. And it's about like dying after a life that's just stagnant and stale and still, and everything that was great has already happened. Her album In the Meantime came out, and I had my headphones and I listened to the whole album, and I listened to that song multiple times, and I wept, because it was exactly what I was feeling about the move, the fear of the move, the fear of standing still, of not having anything to look forward to. And and that was the biggest reason for me moving, was because I felt like I was going nowhere. So I went somewhere. I remember as I was driving away in the east, with New York gone from the rearview mirror, that song was playing in my head, and I was just like, we'll be right back. going to be different for everyone. Side note, I tweeted about how that song was perfect for where I was in my life. It really is the theme song of my life currently. Alessia liked it. And to that point, that was the finest moment of my life. It's a joke, but it was super cool. If you're going for the right reasons, it can be very, very worthwhile. Very, very worthwhile. So that's my journey. That's my little cheat sheet checklist. And I hope this helped you if you're considering moving or are moving. Maybe there's something you forgot. And if there's anything I forgot, please comment below and let me know so we can make this experience smoother and with less of a headache for everyone who watches this video. I thank you for watching. I appreciate you for watching. I love you for watching. Hey, just if you're thinking about moving and it's right for you, then may the wind be at your back and welcome to Las Vegas.